Welcome to the video. Thanks for joining me here. We're going to have a little chat together about what? About the world? About salvation? About the Holy Spirit? About our situation? What can we do? And all of that. Good stuff, great stuff. And of course, I'm likely to have a perspective on it that is very different, very, very different than what's expected. Now, I actually looked at the news today, which I shouldn't have done. Maybe the Holy Spirit wanted me to. And I was really so incensed by what I saw. And I'm trying to let that die down. And and now my take sort of has flip-flopped. And actually I said, hey, this is great. This is really great. Why is this so great? All this terrible stuff that's happening. It's great because this is exactly what I was told about by the Holy Spirit, and I've made so many videos warning the world about what is going to happen, what's to come. And here it is just like clockwork. It's terrible. It is actually terrible. We are descending into a pit. So why is that not terrible? Because the Holy Spirit knew this was coming, has accurately warned us about this, which means the Holy Spirit must know all about this. And that's good news. That's really good news. Because what does the Holy Spirit say? Prepare. He says, we're told we must prepare, spiritually prepare for these times. So it has to have something for us then. Why would we be spiritually preparing for these times? Yes, they're terrible. The Holy Spirit has shown me so many things. Says, look here, look here. I say, wow, that's incredibly terrible. The Holy Spirit says, yeah. Yeah, this is what's coming. And I say, what do I do? And the Holy Spirit says, practice, 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 practice. Prepare, 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 prepare. Be prepared. How? By spiritual practice, right? Spiritual practice. So the Holy Spirit has something up its sleeve, for sure. Why else would it be pointing out all this stuff and saying, prepare for something? Really got to be prepared. Okay. What's it got up his sleeve? I don't know. That's the problem. But I just have to, you know, have faith that there's a reason why we're not told exactly what's going on. I've been given some general parameters. I think there are more than a few people who've been given these general parameters. Between now and in this time of, what, 2016, through the summer of 2016, let's say, a lot of big time trouble and collapse, and then perhaps 2016, from that point you may see war, you may see global World War III as possible. We are in a time now where the action is taking place that we were promised. The action is taking place, ideological action. It's an ideological war, keep in mind. That it's an ideological war that may get physical. Okay, that's a way to look at it. Now, we may also be in the rapture period right now, as a matter of fact. We may have entered into the rapture period May 15th. It's a very, very probable we did, actually. And so we may have a two-year rapture period going right now, as a matter of fact. What exactly that means, we'll have to find out. But I believe that those who are going to sidestep the situation will have sidestepped it likely before the summer of 2016. It's quite likely. There's a lot of foreshadowing going on of what's taking place. We have that ferry disaster in Korea. It was like April 16th, one of those days, maybe April 16th. And did you know that in 1912, on April 15th, virtually the same day if you account for the time difference there. I'm not sure if Korea's on which side of the international time zone, maybe they're a day ahead. The Titanic was in the Atlantic. It could have been even on the same, relative same day. The Titanic hit an iceberg and sank. Which caused just this, you know, unbelievable uproar. Well, this Korean ferry is just causing, you know, it's causing this just like reverberation, shock reverberation. Then, we have the other event, which was the Malaysian airplane went missing. What was that, March 8th or something? March 8th, 2014, March 8th, 2014. In March, like, similar time of March, maybe a little later March, was the 1912, was the expedition to the Antarctica by the explorers from Great Britain, who were lost, and nobody knew what happened to them until November. It turns out they died from exposure and exhaustion and starvation, exposure in Antarctica. And it was a huge deal, especially in Great Britain, and remained so for like 50 years. It's just unbelievably resonated with incredible strength. So you have situations that coming up on similar dates, similar sort of situations. Something's gone missing, Malaysian plane, you know, what happened to these people? Right, what happened? We're all getting theories. Same thing happened with when these explorers never showed up. There was theories, what happened? And then the Titanic, of course, on a similar date to the ferry sinking. Now, what happened after the Titanic 2 years later? It was in, what day was it? July 28th, was it? Or June or July 28th? World War I started. So I wonder if, like, about 2 years and a little later after that, after this situation, will World War III start in 2016? July 2016? It's quite possible, actually. The flooding, it's interesting, the Balkans, you know, the flooding there. The destabilization of the Ukraine and Crimea, the martial law in Thailand, the Vietnam Chinese thing, and the whole Libya thing. Okay, the whole world is seems to be marching towards this, you know, very great destabilization. Ominously so. These events. What was it? 3 days of rain in Bosnia-Herzegovina, 3 days of solid rain, World War III on its way, massive flooding. They said the damage is as bad as the war that happened, you know. Landslides everywhere. That's another sign I've been told to look for, is there's massive landslides and just incredible amount of landslides. It signifies a collapse of order and stability, actually. Landslides. We're getting a constellation of events that, taken as a by themselves, don't mean much, but put all together with the whole picture of what's going on, you've got to say, hey, we are truly in a time is upon us that is very intense, to say the least. Now, there's other events taking place, social events in the United States, for instance. Very bad stuff, actually. Incredibly ominous stuff that's taking place in the United States. That can't help but give you the absolute jitters of what's going on. Paralleling history. History's repeating itself. And I've pointed this out in many videos. I said, the young generation, look out for the young generation. Not everyone, of course. There are many great people in the young generation. But look out. The activism will come from the young generation. When the state becomes the parent to the child, to the children, the young people, that's when the trouble arises. That's when the trouble arises. And I also have said that the young will turn against the older generations and basically want them to die. And we're starting to get celebrities saying, making statements that they feel the older generation needs to die off, needs to die. And that's starting to come up now and you're hearing more and more of that. I said that would take place. And when I say I mean the Holy Spirit inspired this to share this information. Very bad situation is coming up in the world. Especially if you're an older person who's not so stupid as to have been, you know, brainwashed so severely. And you understand the bigger picture. You have a wider scope. You have a scope of history. You have a scope of spiritual teachings. You have a scope of wisdom. You have a scope of your ancestors and their perspective. You see, you have a scope that predated computers and high technology, that predated the extraterrestrial takeover of this planet, really. A lot of what's happening on this planet is preparing the planet for the extraterrestrial, actually, extraterrestrials. They want to have all people on this planet who oppose their hybridization program and the takeover of this planet by these hybrids. They want them all removed in one way or the other. So that they can have a new golden age, you know, ruled over by these hybrids. Alien-human hybrids. So a lot of this stuff that's coming up, zero tolerance policies, you know, if you say anything insensitive, you're lynched immediately. This is all part of the extraterrestrial agenda, actually. Because what they're trying to do is trying to get a certain type of person who's willing to take orders without even thinking about it, to say, okay, you're ordered to bow to this individual and accept their word as your authority. And people will say, okay, it would be insensitive not to. You're told that would be insensitive not to do this. And they say, okay, I can't be insensitive. They're trying to bring about a generation who thinks this way, who's been conditioned to think this way, that any deviation from what is quote-unquote being sensitive to a minority body, which the hybrids will be, of course, in the extreme minority. So what they're trying to do is say any dislike or resistance to being ruled by a minority is off with your head. So they're preparing the world for the hybrids is what they're really doing. Most people don't understand this. They think that, you know, they're not seeing deep enough into down the rabbit hole of what's actually taking place. Again, this hybridization program was okayed at the top levels of the United States in exchange for technology. And other countries also, same deal. The aliens gave them technology, they gave them all sorts of advanced advertising, psychology techniques, and all sorts of gene, you know, how to work on genes, how to bring about computers, microchips, shrinking memory. All this stuff was seeded here in various ways by the extraterrestrials. Some of it through telepathy, some of it maybe directly working in black ops that people are unaware of. Reverse engineering, they may have given them some stuff and say, here, you know, reverse engineer it and figure it out, and stuff like that. But there's lots of different ways. In exchange for that, they were allowed to work on a hybridization program underground in various bases and places they have here. And so this is what's happened. And so now they have their puppets, they have their ways of manipulating society, culture, and they're preparing the culture of the world to be governed by an extreme minority cabal of hybrids, and to feel it would be insensitive not to obey them. You see, you're going to be a racist if you don't obey them, okay? You're going to be a sexist, you're going to be bigoted, you're going to be something, you know. So, in other words, you're going to be a bad, terrible person if you do not accept them as your, you know, as your leaders. This is what's actually going on. If you plug that in, it all makes sense. If you don't plug it in, you're tearing your hair out. Really tearing your hair out and say, why is this happening? Why? It's by design. it's by design. But why does it seem so draconian? You know, everything's getting so draconian, isn't it? Zero tolerance. What is that? People are scratching their heads and say, what's happened to the world? What's happened to America? What's happened to common sense? What's happened to forgiveness? What's happened to, you know, just the basic live and let live? What's happened to free speech? What's happened to our freedoms? What's happened to all that stuff? They can't believe what's happening. It's all by design to condition people and get them ready to be controlled by hybrids, alien-human hybrids. So it's all important to have people who kind of mimic these alien-human hybrids in high positions, celebrities, political figures, you know, people in the public eye, to elevate these people, these groups and various people, types of people, so the population gets used to being ruled by them, told, you know, how to act, how to think, what's sensitive, what is sensitive, what is insensitive. And the public is basically being educated into a state of value and sensitivity so that they will accept the alien-human hybrids as their rulers. Because these hybrids will appear to be superior in a lot of ways, intelligence, and they'll appear to be able to handle, you know, restructuring of the planet and the economic systems and all this stuff. They will appear, you know, mostly human, but different. They'll appear different, which is why there's this campaign to be quote-unquote tolerant and inclusive of all peoples. You know, it's an obsessive thing, isn't it? These people are fanatics. They're obsessed with it. Why? Because they believe that the alien human hybrids will be able to usher in a golden age on this planet. And so they feel it's the only hope they have for happiness. So they're obsessed with it. And you cannot reason with these people at all, because they have this ideal vision of a golden age on this planet, of the alien human hybrids restructuring the planet and bringing peace to this planet. And anyone who does not go along is standing in the way of peace and harmony and light and love and happiness and all this. That they truly believe that. Of course, they're off their rockers, but they will not believe that. They think they're right. They're off their rockers because the fact is, what is our real problem? Our real problem is perception. It is perception itself that's the problem. As long as we're perceiving, we will have all the misery and problems and conflicts of existence that we hate so much and don't understand where they come from. We blame God. We say, oh, God's causing it, or it's just human nature that's causing it, or it's just some few bad people are that way. The rest of us are not, you know, this kind of thing. It actually comes from perception, sensory perception, living in the skin of existence, the flesh. It's the flesh that is the problem. Our real cure is a spiritual cure, not a physical cure. It's a spiritual cure, which is to accept the vision of oneness, the vision of Christ, the vision of holiness, which is not sensory, fleshy perception. It's a feeling of everywhere nowness. It is the light of everywhere nowness. It is the light of all is everywhere right nowness. All the light of everywhere, all is everywhere right nowness. Okay, this is what heals us from the madness of perception, which gives us a feeling of alienation, of separation, of disassociation, of you and me, subject, object. All the conflicts of the personality actually arise from perception. Now, perception arises from where? From our desire to separate from God, to create separately from God. That's where it arises from. So, nowhere in any of the blueprints or plans of the alien hybrids and the aliens and the humans working together, is there any realization that perception is actually the problem. They're approaching on a behavioral level, which is madness, lunacy. It's the wise ones who are able to see, hey, is perception itself that's ill and powerless and isolated and ignorant and frightened and defensive. Inherently so, perception inherently is incredibly problematic. And of itself, it cannot be resolved. It's not like you can perceive something that'll make perception not the way it is. It doesn't matter what you're perceiving. You could be perceiving the most beautiful something in the universe that would not heal the problems of perception. One iota. It would not. The remedy is this feeling, not a sensory, skin, flesh perception, but a feeling, a deep feeling in the mind of this, the light of all is everywhere right now-ness. And I've been talking about this, and it's very important. So you have a situation in the world where the blind are leading the blind. Almost nowhere on this planet is it being pointed out that perception is really the problem. It's actually the problem. And because perception is the problem and vision of oneness is the answer, why don't we just then swap it? We would say, well, if that's true, then how come we're not just choosing to be healed? And there's an answer for that. It's the continuity problem. You see, that is why we do not just immediately exchange perception for vision. What the ego, those who are deluded say is, well, the reason why you don't exchange perception for vision is they say, well, because there is no such thing as vision. That's why you don't do it. It's all a myth. This is the spiel of the atheists and various people, secular humanists in the world right now, who say the reason why you don't accept salvation, the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, the vision of holiness, the vision, the light of all is everywhere right now-ness, is because they say it doesn't exist. It's not there. That's why. It's a myth. It's a lie. It's a deceit. There is no such thing. They claim that is their stand. And that stand is rebutted by the Holy Spirit by saying, the reason why we don't choose it is a continuity fear. It is there. It is there. Many have glimpsed it. I have glimpsed it. I know it's there. There have been some who've actually accepted, made the exchange, for sure. And I know of those who have done that. So many who have done that. So it's a continuity problem because we're afraid of going from perception to vision. It's that simple. Our entire belief system is built upon perception. So we're afraid of exchanging one belief system for another, is what it really is. And one super complex belief system, which is perception, for one just extremely simple and clear belief system, which accompanies vision as a corrective sort of at the conceptual belief level that you can believe, you can have some sort of belief concept there also about vision. So we're simply, terrified of getting out of the boiling oil and sitting under the cool shade of a palm tree or something. We're terrified because of the difference. You say, I'm so used to being cooked alive in this boiling oil. I don't know what I'd do if I got out of the oil. It would be too cold or something. So we have this continuity problem. That means abruptly going from one experience to another experience which has no similarity to the previous experience. An abrupt change of experiencing where the new experience that doesn't have any similarity really, hardly any similarity at all, right? That is called a continuity fear. That is what is causing us to not exchange perception for vision. It's the only reason we don't do it. And by saying it's the only reason we don't do it, meaning the only justifiable reason, we can come up with all sorts of plausibilities, but none of them hold water. None of them hold water. The bottom of the cup is full of holes. So people think that there's all sorts of reasons they don't do it. Not true. I've seen through every one of those. None of them hold water. It's only the continuity problem that holds us back. That's it. Now, I was reading it last night in Journey Beyond Words, the voice of Yeshua Jesus, as heard by Dr. Brent Haskell, PhD, D.O. And Jesus said, look, there is a very simple way for you to reach the light right now. Very simple. This is what I recommend to you. Simply say, I do not know. This world holds nothing that I want. I do not know. I do not know, meaning, I do not know. This world does not tell me what I am at all. I do not know what I am from this world at all, and I never will tell me. It never will tell me. I cannot know what I am by perception. It's impossible. Perception means perception of something. So we're here in this world. Perception is taking place in this world. So perception of this world, I cannot know what I am. Impossible. So it's, I do not know. And state that, he says, in a positive way, not like a frightened way, but a very saying, wow, this is great that I don't know. Because that means I must be something else other than what the world is telling me, which is great news, right? Because what the world tells us is that we're just this, you know, little bug, little perceptual bug, and we're not that. So I do not know is a statement of liberation, of freedom. It should be said in a happy way. So I was able to say it in a joyful, positive way, and I felt, and Jesus said, when you do that, the doors of heaven will open up to you. The doors of eternity, eternal life will open for you. And I began to feel that this was happening. I said, wow, I can feel it happening. And then I kind of said, whoa. Like that. And he said, whoa. I was like, wow. So I didn't quite, you know, go all the way through the door. I should have. But that's called a continuity problem. It bedevils everybody. So we can get to that point, like, wow, I'm here, I can feel my freedom. And then we kind of back away from it. That's the problem. So those who claim there's no such thing, you know, as vision, the light of all is everywhere right nowness, they simply are mistaken. Okay, they're flat earthers, you know, who it just suits their perspective. It suits them to say such a thing because it validates their spiritual pride. You know, they're like, there is no way back home. That's why I'm here. I'm not here because I'm trying to be greater than God. There is no way home. So it's kind of a defensive position to take that in the face of so much evidence to the contrary. So the intelligent people of this planet work on the continuity problem. Okay, that's a sign of intelligence. It's you say, hey, I know all perception, all of this is something I dreamed up. My spirit dreamed it up. It's not going to work. We cannot change reality. We cannot create a separate reality. We cannot create creations that don't know their creator. It's impossible. So I know we have to give this up and go back home. So what's the problem? Oh, continuity problem. That's the only problem there is. Let's work on it then. That's intelligence. And then you just get about working on it. Is it what you do? Well, meanwhile, everybody else is frantically crossing swords, you know, dueling like crazy. Saying, you know, my perception is better than your perception. It's all perceptual warfare that's taking place. And always will be. Perception will always be at war with itself. Guaranteed. There is no peace in perception. There is no peace in perception. None whatsoever. But there's only peace in vision. There's only peace in vision. Because the feeling of the light of all is everywhere now, right nowness. What does it have to accomplish? It's already accomplishing everything, is it not? It's totally accomplished. Imagine that feeling. That is the feeling of our identity. Total accomplished, totally accomplished. Inherently so. Everlessly so. Nothing excluded. everything, manifest and unmanifest, is equally in this moment, no matter where appearances seem to be located in space. Makes absolutely no difference to the feeling at all. None. This totally accomplished feeling. No conflict, no battle, no stress, no insecurity, no instability. This is a feeling. So obviously, if we're having this feeling, it's peace. It's peace. It's just peace. It's 100% peace. So there's no conflict in there. So there's no conflict. There's no conflict in that feeling. Those who abide in that feeling, there's no conflict there. Now they may admonish others to remind them that perception is conflict. There's no peace in perception, never will be, and there's only peace in vision. So there may be admonishments and saying, you know, this is the truth. Listen to this, hear this, pay attention, get to work on the continuity problem. It's unassailable peace. It's absolutely unassailable. Now, before we really identified with our bodies severely when we were younger, some, you know, we could maybe sit down and at times we'd just feel that unassailable peace. Because really we're not identifying with our body so much. You know, every society is telling us, you got to identify with your body. You gotta, but maybe we weren't too keen on that. You know, and just say, well, not really interested too much in that. And you would feel this unassailable peace. It had nothing to do with your body, or this body, or that. It's the total assurance of the now. The everywhere nowness, the total assurance of the everywhere nowness. This is how we find peace. We will not ever find it by crossing swords with other perceivers, you know. It's guaranteed you're going to have different viewpoints and perception. It's nothing but a swamp of conflict, actually. And those who think that they can find peace through perception are the most dangerous ones of all. Because they'll join together with others who have that belief. And inevitably they end up scapegoating so many people. And eventually they end up scapegoating themselves, become cannibalistic, until there's nothing left. This is just a basic fact of perception, how perception works. So, it's religion is very good in that it says, look, there's a higher power, something higher, greater than us. What does it mean? By it means there's something greater than perception is what it really means. Something, some life that is not bound or limited by sensory perception. This is the confession of a religious minded person. It should be. That is the true confession, which is a very good starting point. A very necessary starting point. Now, it doesn't mean that they're wise once they say, I know there is something greater than sensory perception. They've had an inner experience of it, for example. That doesn't mean that they still don't have a severe continuity problem and may act accordingly, or certainly will act accordingly. They do, and of course they may seem foolish at times, which is why we are told in religious society is to practice forgiveness. Practice forgiveness because, and then help and admonish and support and help them back on the track, keep them on track, and don't act out the continuity fear too severely here. Let's try to keep it, you know, try to keep it in the fairway here. That's, you have to do that. That's absolutely necessary. First, you have to realize, yes, there is something greater than sensory perception. And then you realize, I do have a severe continuity problem. Call it sin. You know, call it sin. A good term for saying this continuity problem. Say, wow, I feel this. I have a hard. I don't know if I can get back to, you know, to the good graces of God's will. I feel like I don't know how to get back home. It's a continuity problem. And so we work on that. We work on that throughout our life as much as possible. And you get help, get an encouragement, get support. You see, that's the right society. That's the golden age. That's the golden age. But we're not headed for a golden age here in this world. We are not headed for a golden age. We are headed towards a let's get rid of everybody who doesn't perceive it the way do age. Now, of course, those who are aware of the vision of oneness, of course, they're in a much wiser state of mind, much more responsible state of mind than those who, certainly than those who deny it. You know, they're deeply in darkness, the ones who deny it. Say it's a myth, it's not real, etc., etc. The perception is queen, you know, they know. They're being very irresponsible and should not have a say in governance, in society, in laws and regulations. They should have no say whatsoever in any of that, because they are bound to implement extremely irresponsible legislation, laws, social strictures, rules, regulation, ethics, morals, etc., etc., etc. Bound to implement very irresponsible civilization and society. Inherently so, because their very position is extremely irresponsible and ignorant. Now, that's not to say that, again, those who believe that there is a higher power, higher purpose, etc., that they always are going to act wise. That's not true. Obviously, history has shown us that's not true. But it's certainly a lot better than the totally irresponsible ones. And it gets better, it supposedly should get better, as the community of support helps it along. The continuity problem definitely causes a stumbling and bumbling along the way. But there's no way around that, really. You can't just default and say, oh, you're stumbling and bumbling, so let's call it all off. Let's call it all a myth. You know, no. That's crazy. That's irresponsible. And that's the kind of world we have now. We have an irresponsible world headed that way, by and large. What we're told is that, well, it's okay to have believe in God and religion and stuff, but as long as you understand that this is just a way of making yourself feel good, it's just a self-esteem sort of thing you're doing. You see, they psychologize it, right? So that's where we're at right now. The last 50 years have been a psychologizing of spiritual faith into it is simply a part of the human brain personality. A way of making yourself feel significant and loved and okay. It's a way of feeling okay about yourself. This is what's happened. They've psychologized it into this. That's what's been going on. And then from there, it's a hop, skip, and a jump to saying it's actually an archaic, archaic part of the brain that is just mythologizing in order to feel more secure. And it comes from that, and those who have dropped that are superior, they're more advanced. That's just why the hybrids, alien-human hybrids, people will think they're more advanced because they don't have this religious, spiritual aspect to them. And the what's being told is that this whole spiritual religious belief is something that is an archaic myth and actually a sign of an insecure, uneducated personality and bad DNA, you know, bad genes, bad DNA is what they'll get to. And We're virtually there, actually. I mean, when's disclosure going to be made? It's already Clinton and Pope Francis, and you know, they're all talking about it, right? It's been going on for leaders of the world are now saying, hey, what about disclosure? You know, if it happened, you know, I'd say, hey, I'd welcome you. They're getting us. They're not so bad. They're just like us. These are hybrids. So this is what's going on in the world. If you look at this way, everything just fits, and you say, oh my gosh, that's what's happening. Yeah. Now, of course, those of us who know about the vision of oneness, who've experienced it, and some who are abiding it, actually, you know, they'll be people. They will say they have like extremely defective DNA. In fact, their DNA is so terrible that we have to eliminate them and incinerate them completely, so there's not a trace of them left. Because in this age now, of course, we know we can take just any little cell of a body, right, and get the DNA from it and then work on replication. They're working on replication like that, from just the DNA of a cell, just a minute amount, whatever. So if there's any part of the body of a person who believes, you know, in the vision of oneness, anywhere on the planet, they're afraid that someone, some mad scientist might get a hair, you know, a hair follicle or something of such a body and replicate this person, you know, and they'll have this, you know, replication of these religious-minded people. Oh my God, you know, they can't have that. So they want to completely annihilate, you know, these people. That's what they feel. Only then will they be safe. Because they believe that this religion, spiritual belief, is a genetic regression, which threatens their survival. So they cannot have the gene pool contaminated by these people. And we have to keep a sense of humor and laugh about this, because we're above all this, actually. We're just looking down on the madness of it. You know, madness actually has quite a bit of humor about it. If we were watching opera or a play where these people are just behaving so madly like this, we would have a great, good laugh. In fact, that's often what theater is the audience gets to watch actors and actresses playing out human madness, you know, on a stage, and we feel like, hey, we're above this, you know, we're above it because we're watching it. Like that, we have a good laugh. Shakespeare is very good at that, and, you know, some playwrights. So it is a mad farce, a madcap farce that's taking place right now. Absolutely. We're right in the midst of it right now. Maybe Act 3 is coming soon. For sure, the next act is on its way. So, it's a good idea to sidestep all this, right? Because they don't like these sidestepping. They want to know where the body is buried, meaning they want to know that you've been incinerated. There's no organic. Nothing organic left to your body whatsoever, so nobody can replicate it. But if we just take off somewhere, it's like, oh, maybe they'll come back. Maybe they'll come back. Oh my God, these crazy people who believe in God, who believe in a higher power, who believe in vision, believe in something beyond sensory perception, believe in the light of all is everywhere right nowness. Believe in this, the bliss of the vision of oneness, and maybe they'll come back and contaminate our wonderful golden age here. You know, we can't have that. It's funny stuff, and it's all coming to you in living technicolor. Coming to a theater near you, as a matter of fact. Yeah. And they're getting the ball rolling on all this stuff, using the younger generation to spy on the older generation, of course. We knew that was coming. That's an easy get, that one. And of course, I told you that smartphones will be used to record, that young people now use those to record what conversations, especially of their parents, aunts, uncles, relatives, grandparents, grandmothers, grandparents, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Record their conversations surreptitiously, of course. And then go through, you know, and probably, there'll probably be apps that'll like, they'll run it through an app, you know, which will pick out, algorithm pick out various words and phrases and thoughts and stuff. And they'll start profiling, you know, the older generation this way. And you have celebrities saying like, it's what we need is for the older generation to die, you know, to die. Yeah, so this is what's happening. The taping, surreptitious taping, videoing, voice recording of the older generation, that is what's coming. And initially it will be used to catch people making slurs of various things or jokes about various groups and saying things that are insensitive, you know, or not appropriate or whatever. But eventually then it also will morph into religious convictions. Okay, that's the real target of all this. The real target is to target religion with the belief there's something greater than the body, there's something beyond the body, that sensory perception is not the end all and be all. There's something greater than that. That's what's targeted. That's the belief that's targeted on all of the stuff that's taking place. They want to eradicate that from the planet. They want to make perception the empress, you know, the queen of the universe is perception. They want perception to be the queen of the universe. And to serve that queen as loyal and obedient subjects, thinking that that's going to bring peace. And so when it doesn't, they say, well, there must be more, we need to ferret out more, there must be some hidden believers here in the world somewhere. So this is I've said that the social media and smartphones, all this is going to be used by the young people of the world to spy on the older generation, to inform upon them, and to do the work of, you know, getting rid of them. that's what's happening. And you think, oh, that couldn't happen. Oh, it's happened quite a few times in history before, where the youth were the ones that got rid of the older generations. That these people don't get it. You know, let's get rid of them. We're in a hurry. We don't have time to wait for them to die. Let's have them die right now. You know, Pol Pot was good at that. A lot of various times in history have been good at that, getting rid of the older generation. And we're right there right now, right on track with that, right on track, as the Holy Spirit has pointed out. So it's kind of like you have these little children who are having these crazy fantasies, playing these little fantasy games, you know. As a parent, you're kind of like laughing and chuckling at them, you know, their crazy little fantasy games. But saying that, we also want to sidestep this, you see. We don't particularly want to be incinerated. Most importantly, we don't want our brothers and sisters to have to do that to us, you see. Because deep down, you know, they're going to feel like, wow, you know, this is too heavy situation, I don't like this. No, it's better to sidestep it. Now the ego says, no, there's a conflict, like, no, you need to help them out. And well, we'll look at that. I've looked at that already. I'll look at that pretty carefully. I say sidestep it, all right. Some will say to be martyrs is more helpful, you know, and they want to do that, fine. But I believe that those who feel that sidestepping it is appropriate should also feel fine about that. I can feel this is a very contentious issue. I can feel a reaction within me. Because again, those who want to eliminate this, they don't want anyone to escape. They want everyone to be martyred and then completely incinerated. Not enough to bury him. No, they won't do that. No way. Because, again, the science and technology of replication is rapidly coming upon us, actually. They're going to be replicating, you know, it's Jurassic Park. They'll be able to replicate ancient, you know, dinosaurs, ancient creatures, and things like that. They're getting there. They're getting there. And with the help of the ETs who know how to do this, they will most certainly be doing this. They may even have dinosaurs tracking down people, you know, and eating them and stuff. You know, this stuff is not far-fetched, actually. The ETs do know how to replicate. And you could replicate dinosaurs, so getting DNA from ancient fossils, etc. is possible. So, feeling this wall of resistance around this right now. Now, all is every, the light of all is everywhere. Everywhere right nowness. Everywhere right nowness, this feeling. This is absolute truth. This is absolute truth. This has been testified to many, many, many times throughout the ages. And the wisest of the wise people in each epoch and era and time and civilization have seen this and realized it, have said, yes, this is true. Many have glimpsed it. Many say, confess, this is true. Many people who have experienced this, called born again, whatever you want to call it, that people who have this experience to say, wow, there is something beyond the body. There is something beyond the flesh, the senses. There is something beyond perception. Something way better, way better. They did a poll among scientists recently, and you know, most scientists do not have a real strong conviction in God, in something greater. Some say they're religious, they go to church, etc., but they don't have this core belief. Very, very few do, actually. So I'm running and feeling this, just have to let this, oof, you know, this resistance, let's see, let it just mellow out. Covering a lot of territory here, very intense territory. Interesting. They may want us to stay here and say, no, I need you to teach. You're welcome. No, we want you to teach here, you know, and ramp up, and pop, 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 like that. They may want people here to try and galvanize a revival here in the world that brings everybody out of the woodwork, all of those who are believers, for the purpose of identifying them. so they can be more easily eliminated. This is a possibility, actually. This may be why the Holy Spirit has not told me everything and told me to lay low. You gotta stay low, actually, in this time. As far as going out and, you know, galvanizing people out of the woodwork and, you know, getting everybody to say, hey, you know what, I too believe in a higher power. I too believe in a vision. This is my stance. And because then it makes it easier for to be identified that way and dealt with as a possibility. And that's really heavy stuff. I hadn't thought of that. That was very sobering. I think maybe a lot of people want to keep that information as private as possible. But in the climate that's to come in this world, you know, you're going to live in terror and fear of saying something, let something slip. That, a slip of the tongue is all that it takes, you know. You're at a cashier in a supermarket chatting you up, and suddenly they say something that brings out a slip of the tongue. There's like a young cashier there, a young bagger, clerk or something there. They got it on their smartphone. Busted. You know, you're busted. They got on their video or something, right? There'll be an informist society is what we're headed towards. Everywhere all being spied on already, all our keystrokes are being spied on. If you visit various websites, they have your, you know, what you visited, etc. So they're already profiling you. So what I'm feeling is by trying to reach out to people in this world, what I'm feeling is a tremendous resistance and fear. They say, no, don't bring me out of the closet. They want to stay in the closet, you know. They want to stay in the spiritual closet, actually, thinking they're going to ride this storm out. No. Not going to ride it out well at all. I don't believe that. So this is a tough call. I'm going to just have to ask the Holy Spirit about this one. Do we put on a full court press, bring everyone out of the closet we can, say, hey, look, this is a situation. We need to sidestep this situation. Let's work on that. Let's not worry about the future of this planet. So let's work on sidestepping this whole situation in a positive way, a spiritual way. But I would say the fear at this point is too much for people. It's too much. The iron fist, the black hand is already upon them. Now I just talk because it's too late for me. You know, there's no point. I can't get back in the closet, as it were. I decided to come out of the closet. And, you know, once you do that, you know, you're out. So there's no point in trying to be quiet at this point. But there are many who are thinking like, hey, you know, I better lay low. It's kind of like the Jews in Germany thinking, hey, we better just not say anything. Let's just not rock the boat. Let's just lay low and ride this storm out. Well, that didn't work out very well for them, did it? But that's the mentality. Let's get along, not rock the boat. Let's accept that, yeah, religion is kind of it's a self-esteem sort of thing that, yeah. Let's sort of accept that. Yeah, I go to church, but you know, I don't really believe this stuff. Or it's just something I do to kind of, you know, feel more connected and feel good. I just do it to be a better person, really morally a better person. You know, not really sure about exactly the higher power. You know, it gradually, you see, you gradually, bit by bit, you let go of all of that, and you just say, oh, I'm just trying to be a good person. That's all. Good human being. I'm just a human being. This is what I am. The body, the senses, that's what I am. No, there's nothing greater than that. not that I can attain to. And so I'm just trying to be a good person, get along with everybody, be very tolerant, and appreciate everything, and do what the authorities tell me to do, and that's it. But one day they'll come knocking at your door and say, hey, you know, your grandparents and your parents were very religious people. Probably have defective genes, genetic. We'll do some testing on you. So you need to come with us. We'll do some testing. And lo and behold, the tests come back and say, oh, yeah, you know, you actually do have this genetic strain which causes you to have this brain misfunction that occasionally you're potentially subject to religious epiphanies and various religious hallucinations and religious psychotic episodes and such. So we're going to need to do some work on your brain, do some work there and see if we can't cure that. But actually, we feel it's oftentimes incurable. So we need to isolate you from the rest of society for the good of society, of course. And so that's what we're going to do. See, that's how it goes. And it's incurable. even if you're in the closet entirely, no, I'm just a good person. I don't have any religious visions. Never have. I just go, for the ethics. Be good to one another. That's all I'm interested in. They say, well, but your history, your genetic history shows that you have the potential to, potentially, not that you have, but you might. You might at some point because of your genetics. So we have to segregate you from the rest of society in case it might happen at some point, and then you'd disturb the social order, you see. It'd make people feel uncomfortable. You might start talking about God, and that really would cause people to be very shaken up and rattled, because they feel that, they live in a sane society. When someone suddenly becomes insane like that, it's very demoralizing for them, it's not good for their the morale of society. So in case that might ever happen, we need to send you to this nice little place here and keep you away from the rest of the good folks. This is how it works. So, you will not be safe just because you turn into a quisling and say, oh, no, like Peter, no, I don't know Jesus at all. Never heard of him. No. I don't know that man. Never met him, never heard of him, never seen him, and don't know anything about him. It doesn't work. Because they'll dig deeper and look at your family tree, all your history online, and all your purchases, everything they have. And they'll say, well, you have shown an indication that you're interested in that stuff. And that usually is an indication that you have the potential, at least. In fact, there's a surefire bet you have the potential at some point to have a psychotic episode, you see. So, we got to make sure that doesn't happen. Here's some medication. Actually, you need to take this medication to prevent it. And of course, this medication will turn you into a vegetable. Or cause genuine psychotic breakdowns, which then they say, wow, you've got psychotic, we really need to now segregate you from the rest of the population. This is the madness we're going into. We're going into this utter whimsical, farcical madness of perception and its desire to be, to be a more enjoyable experience than reality. So we can say, I don't need reality. I created something better than God. So there's this huge push to, we got to figure out why isn't it enjoyable for us? Why isn't it more enjoyable? If we feel there's something within us that's not quite satisfied. Why aren't we satisfied? We keep asking ourselves. Well, we got these crazy people saying there's something better. Of course we're not going to be satisfied if we believe there's something better. It's only a belief, they say. It's only a belief. So if we just get rid of this belief, we'll be happy. You see? They don't understand that this dissatisfaction is coming from within, the truth within them, that which they cannot separate from. They believe it's only a belief. And so if they get rid of the belief that there's something better, then they won't be bugged by that anymore, and then they'll be perfectly happy forever after. This is a fairy tale. Live happily ever after. It's a fairy tale they're telling themselves. So it's not as safe as it seems to jump into the closet and close the closet door. I believe it's safer to come out of the closet. At least you know then that you're in danger and threatened as far as, you know, this aspect of it, as far as the body goes. Now, the early Christians, they embraced martyrdom, actually. They embraced it. It was the way to heaven for them. So they say, hey, you want to kill my body? Great, go ahead. Hurry up. I can't wait to join Jesus in heaven. That's their perspective. And it is possible to have such a perspective, actually. It is possible. I don't think that we're fit. The situation, the glove doesn't fit. You know, the shoe doesn't fit these times, actually. But I can understand how it is possible to feel that way, knowing that the body's nothing. It's useless, actually. As far as telling us what we are, it's absolutely useless. So it is possible for the community of belief to become so strong and so spiritualized, people will just say, I don't need the body anyway. If you want to get rid of it, go ahead. It's useless to me. I don't need use for it. But I'm somewhat doubtful that's going to be the mood of the times. I don't read that into anything the Holy Spirit said, and then the little voice inside me says, wrong, wrong. You know, that's the ego. It sounds like that's the ego. The ego, you know, wants blood of the saints on their hands, actually. They'll feel empowered. They say, look, I got evidence I got rid of this belief. You know, here's the evidence. I got blood on my hands. We got rid of this belief, and now we're going to be happy forever after. Because they say, think it's only a belief. A crazy belief, a psychotic belief, there's something greater. Not any reality to it. And so, not hearing that belief anywhere won't contaminate them, you see. So they want, you know, blood on their hands for sure. And there will be quite a few who will oblige them for sure. But I don't think it's a good idea to oblige them. It only sort of feeds their madness, actually. It's better for them to think, well, that belief's out there somewhere. That belief's out there somewhere. And better to make them sweat, actually. Better to make them suffer, that fear. Because the more they think about it, you know, it's on their mind. Whereas they think, okay, we just eliminate everybody has that belief. We got rid of the belief. We should everyone be happy now. And if we're not, let's make sure we take these medications. And they'll think, you know, they've made it. And that may be a harder egg to crack, actually, later on. But if they think, you know what, we failed, you know, they escaped. They may come back. The return, you know, the return of this belief. The return of the belief in Christ. The return of the belief in vision. May happen in 1,000 years or two. We better prepare for it. And then they start, you know, thinking, oh my gosh. And it becomes, they become obsessed with it. They're very unhappy, you know, and then the whole impetus to try and enthrone perception breaks down, and they're back and they're griping and conflicting, you know, and it's terrible, terrible. But they're actually going closer towards, you know, being able to finally drop perception, because they'll have an epiphany at some point, and they'll say, wow, you know, hey, I just had a psychotic breakdown, but it was kind of cool. In fact, it was really great. It's like, huh. I thought it was like really dangerous, but maybe it's not, you know. And so they'll go like that. Maybe it's not so bad. So an underground will grow, you know, and the religion will spring up, you know, and the whole thing will blossom again, type of thing. Take a while. But you cannot just prove them wrong, like say, okay, here, martyr the body. I don't care. And because they think, no, that's just a sign of your psychosis. It's just a proof of your psychosis, actually. Total proof of your psychosis. And that they got rid of the psychosis, you see. And then so that it feels different. They feel empowered like that. Because you're dealing with madness here. You're not dealing with sanity. Interesting to look at the future like this. The Holy Spirit, you know, encourages to look at the future like this, to see how does history happen? It happens like this. It's the drama between perception and its fear of vision. It's the drama's within perception. It's not within vision. There's no drama in vision at all. None. It's perception has a drama within with itself, with its fear of vision. And so there's all this drama in perception that just keeps playing out. There is no kill shot way to stop it, you know, from a sociological standpoint. There isn't any such way. It just keeps playing out and gradually some, you know, manage to get off to the fringes and escape it. Gradually this escape, you know, occurs. So I'm trading on some very sensitive territory here. I'm getting some reactions, inner reactions, that disagreeing with me. It's like, it's unusual, so it's like, wow. Because they see the martyrdom, getting rid of these people who believe in God, as the way to their happiness. This is how they will achieve happiness, is they'll eradicate the belief that there's something better. They'll eradicate this, and therefore there won't be anything internally making them feel dissatisfied. So they think that by believing there's something else better, that's what's causing the dissatisfaction. See? So they get rid of that, they say, then for sure we're going to be happy. But they've misplaced the cause of their dissatisfaction. It's not because of a belief system, it's because of the reality that they are. They cannot eradicate that. So they'll enter into a golden age, they think, and they'll try to spread it, and they'll do all these things to try and rationalize this feeling away inside of them. They'll say, well, we have it now, but there are others out there who don't have it, so we need to proselytize the golden age to them. You see, this feeling of dissatisfaction is because we have not yet saved everybody in the universe from the false belief in God, so we need to proselytize, and so the energy will go into that, and that can go on and on and on and on. You can really kick the can down the road this way. Oh, it's not within me, it's out there. This is a basic projection. It's not a dissatisfaction. I'll say, it's not within me, it's out there. And therefore I need to eradicate it out there. There's this ceaseless, you know, eradication monster that keeps prowling throughout the universe. And it's coming our way. This eradication monster's coming our way. It really is a monster, you know, and it's coming toward the earth now. You know, it's, you know, everybody's like trying to appease it. Yes, monster, we believe, you know, we'll serve you. Interesting, we have these monster movies now, this gigantic monster coming in, you know. People, you know, like that. It's like that, really. This is just a sort of a archetypal way of symbolizing this monstrous desire and drive to eradicate the belief in something greater than perception. And see, the people say, ah, there's nothing greater, but once you die, that's it. Perception's done, so there's nothing else. That's the worship of perception. They cannot even admit there could be something better than perception, because if they do, the Holy Spirit will speak to them and says, hey, yeah, I've got it right here, it's vision. In fact, you can experience it. And they might have an experience of it. And it's like, whoa, you know, that's way better, incomparably better. And they're terrified of that because of continuity fear. So we're just getting the ABCs of the future right here. ABCs of the future. It's all coming to pass like this. It's all coming to pass. You know, we're already in such a completely insane situation compared to pre-9/11, right? Pre-9/11. Just take pre-9/11 and then take right now and tell me if we are not in the twilight zone right now. And by comparison, we're in such an incredible twilight zone. And go back earlier. Go back to the 90s, the 80s, the 70s, the 60s, 50s, 40s. You know, we are in an extreme twilight zone. The stuff that's happening is twilight zone stuff that would be just like comic book inconceivable, crazy, nuts stuff that's taking place. Now, nobody even, you know, hardly says a second word about it, really. Sure, we're going to tape everyone's conversations, sort of tips like that, and inform on our parents and send them off to re-education camps and, you know, doing rate of replication and blah, 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 blah. This is all like comic book stuff. Comic book stuff. Of course, the comic books were used to train the young people to say, this is what you need to do. This is what's cool. This is what's cool. This is what you should be doing. So we have this comic book culture right now, actually, who have been rehearsing their roles, actually. They're into role rehearsal. They didn't dress up, you know. They're into role rehearsal. These comic book characters who are from the future, who do these things, yeah. So they'd say, oh yeah, I'm used to this. I've been into this comic book character, and that's what they do. They fight the evil. They get rid of the false beliefs, the things that are holding back the progress of science and technology and civilization and happiness. And they make sure that they're super sleuths, detectives who find out, root out the evil elements in society, those terrible people who believe that there's a higher purpose to life than you know, than serving the goddess of perception. Goddess of perception, commerce, flesh, and all of that sensuality and all the whole thing, you know. Goddess of gambling and good times. something greater than that. Oh, wow, we gotta get rid of them. They're dangerous to our happiness. You know, comic book stuff, and yet here it is. We're living in a comic book, actually. What's that song, Take On Me? It's like that, the video of the comic book. You know, you get pulled into a comic book. What was that, the 1984 or something, Take On Me? That's what's happened. We've been pulled into the pages of a comic book, as a matter of fact. And we need someone to pull us out of the pages of that comic book, don't we? That is for sure. That's going to be an interesting one. That's the Holy Spirit's job. So we will see how we get pulled out of the pages of this comic book we're in, right? Because I think some of us are not too keen on the, you know, the next frame of this comic book, the next page, etc., etc. Yeah. And of course we get pulled into the page of the comic book by the siren, the beautiful siren. Oh, come and save me, you know. The bad guys are chasing me. Come and save me. Whoops, and then you're in the comic book. And then all this stuff, crazy stuff starts happening. That's what's happened. We've been pulled into a comic book, maybe since 1984. Maybe that's when the time we got pulled into it, actually. Or Orwell, 1984. You know, he probably nailed it on the head with the date, actually. How many years has that been? 30 years, hasn't it? 30 years in a comic book. Imagine the people have been born into this culture 30 years, living in a comic book. Now some of them realize this. They say, they call it the Matrix. It's really, you know, it's a comic book, actually. And they say, wow, how do we get out of this comic book? How do we get out of the Matrix? You know, wow. Well, that's the Holy Spirit's job. The Holy Spirit's job. just the bad guys are coming for us in the comic book, you know, and then poof, we leave the frame of the comic book, you know, we're no longer in the comic book. We're no longer in this linear time, space, appearances, and time, so linear 3D, 4D matrix. We're in the everywhere nowness, the light of everywhere nowness. We're experiencing the light of everywhere. That's what it feels like. Get pulled out of a comic book. We're now experiencing the light of everywhere nowness. Like, wow, I just got pulled out of the comic book. That's really cool. Cat is saying I'm running long. I don't know. It doesn't seem that way. But the producer is saying, hey, maybe that's enough for one video. You know, so probably is. It's a great, you know, it's been a great video here. It's able to spill the beans and you know, talk about what's going on, what will happen. It's all very, you know, dystopian. It's all this comic book, and yeah, it's exactly what's going on. So, we continue to focus on allowing ourselves to be pulled out of this page of this comic book, which is this vision of oneness, which is this feeling of everywhere nowness, everywhere right nowness. All is everywhere right nowness. All is everywhere right nowness. All is everywhere right nowness. And meditating on this, if you meditate on it, really try to dig into it, you will find this amazing, just, whoa, this is incredible. This is fantastic. You know, this is what I really want. This is what I really want. I want that feeling. I want the feeling of everywhere right nowness. That's the feeling I want. That's the feeling I've been missing. That's the inner discontent that I've had all along, that I wanted to feel that way, and perception wouldn't let me. You see, perception can never feel that way. So just meditate on everywhere right nowness, or everywhere nowness, everywhere right nowness. Everywhere nowness, if you want to simply, everywhere nowness. All is everywhere right nowness. All is everywhere nowness. The light of all is everywhere right nowness. Just meditate on that. And that can be an incredible meditation. An incredible meditation. Okay, very good. The cat says that's a wrap. Thanks for watching. That's it.